Good morning and welcome to our service for the third Sunday after Trinity. How did we get to the third Sunday already? Time just seems to be going so quickly. Tomorrow is the feast of St. Peter and Paul, which is the traditional time for ordinations to take place. Now this year, because of the virus, the ordinations haven't been able to take place. I'd like you to think particularly of those people who should have been ordained deacon or priest at this time. The deacons are being licensed as lay ministers so that they can begin their curacies. But it's going to be a very strange time for them as they settle into their parishes in the aftermath of the pandemic. So please hold those people in your prayers at this time. And we're going to begin our service with the wonderful hymn, How Great Thou Art.
Lord, my God, when I innocent was.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. Jesus said, "Anyone who receives you receives me, and anyone who receives me receives the Father who sent me." So we gather today in the presence of God, who receives us with open arms, who loves us unconditionally, and who bids us to do the same to one another. And so let's worship God together. And we begin with a prayer of preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. As we prepare to celebrate the presence of Christ in word and sacrament, let us now call to mind and confess our sins. Lord, you come to heal the wounds of sin and division. Lord, have mercy. Lord, you come to help us to see one another, not as strangers, but as brothers and sisters in God's family. Christ, have mercy. Lord, you help us to make room in our hearts for the lost, the lonely, and the rejected. Lord, have mercy. Have mercy on us, Lord, in your compassion, and lead us to the joys of everlasting life. Amen. We say the words of the Gloria together. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. And our special prayer, the Collect for today. Let us pray. God our Saviour, look on this wounded world in pity and in power. Hold us fast to your promises of peace, won for us by your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And our first reading this morning, in fact, both readings this morning, read by Sandy from St. Saviour's at Afton.
Jeremiah chapter 28, verses 5 to 9. Then the prophet Jeremiah spoke to the prophet Hananiah in the presence of the priests and all the people who were standing in the house of the Lord. And the prophet Jeremiah said, Amen. May the Lord do so. May the Lord fulfil the word that you have prophesied and bring back to this place from Babylon the vessels of the house of the Lord and all the exiles. But listen now to the word that I speak in your hearing and in the hearing of all the people. The prophets who preceded you and me from ancient times prophesied war, famine, and pestilence against many countries and great kingdoms. As for the prophet who prophesies peace, when the word of that prophet comes true, then it will be known that the Lord has truly sent the prophet. Romans chapter 16, verse 12 to the end. Therefore, do not let sin exercise dominion in your mortal bodies to make you obey their passions. No longer present your members to sin as instruments of wickedness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and present your members to God as instruments of righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. What then? Should we sin because we are not under law, but under grace? By no means. Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness. But thanks be to God that you, having once been slaves of sin, have become obedient from the heart to the form of teaching to which you were entrusted, and that you, having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness. I am speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations. For just as you once presented your members as slaves to impurity and to greater and greater iniquity, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness for sanctification. When you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. So what advantage did you then get from the things of which you are now ashamed? The end of those things is death. But now that you have been freed from sin and enslaved to God, the advantage you get is sanctification. The end is eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ.
This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. And whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of these will lose their reward. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. And so may I speak in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now, after my father took retirement from teaching, he and his wife Kate entered the hospitality industry. And they ran a guest house. It was situated just outside the beautiful village of Crickhowell in South Wales. And it was always a pleasure to go and stay there. It was so comfortable. And there were stunning views over the Usk Valley towards the Black Mountains. And Kate is a wonderful cook, so the food was always delicious. And my father was a very genial host. Now, the name of the guest house was T. Croso, and that means house of welcome. And in Welsh, T means house, and Croso means welcome. And by the way, if you're in Wales and someone asks you where the T Bach is, that means little house, and they're probably asking you where the bathroom is. Now, Dad and Kate worked very hard to offer a very high standard of hospitality to their guests. And as a result, T. Croso lived up to its name, with a reputation of giving guests a very warm and friendly welcome. Now, in this week's short passage from Matthew's Gospel, we hear the summing up of the instructions and advice that Jesus gives as he sends his disciples out to be witnesses. Whoever welcomes the disciples welcomes him. And a cup of water becomes a symbol of hospitality. A cup of cold water for a hot, tired and dusty traveller. And to be hospitable, to be welcoming, is to provide another person with the basics of food and shelter. But it's far more than that. To offer hospitality is not an impersonal exercise. A simple glass of water is an embodied way of saying to another human being that they matter, that you are glad to see them, that you're enjoying their company. And here in Matthew's Gospel, we are told that in welcoming another human being, we are welcoming God. And a disciple's character, action, and words are to be such that they can be identified as belonging to Jesus. When followers of Jesus are welcomed, it is as if Jesus himself is welcomed, and his Father who sent him too. And while a welcome into our home had a far stronger cultural basis than we may experience today, nevertheless, there are actions with others in any medium or location should be in some way bring Jesus into the encounter. Now, nowadays, hospitality is very different from what it was in the old days when nobody locked their doors. Sadly, today we have locks and bolts, chains, peepholes, alarm systems, sometimes even guard dogs. And yet today there is more need for hospitality and friendliness than ever. In the world today, there are many who are regarded as strangers or aliens. Hospitality towards a friend is no big deal. There's likely to be no risk involved, and every likelihood that the favour will be returned. But Christ calls us to welcome the stranger into our midst. To be hospitable does not mean making them like us. It means accepting them as what they are. Now, in this time of coronavirus, hospitality, like everything else, has changed. It's needed to adapt. And we haven't been able to physically invite people into our homes or even into our churches. Many of us haven't even been able to give our close relatives a hug if they don't live in our household. But that hasn't meant that we haven't been welcoming. The challenge has been to find new and inventive ways of telling people that they matter and of giving reassurance and comfort. And many people have been able to welcome people into their homes using the wonders of electronic communication. Many people have got to know their neighbours, who perhaps they've never spoken to before, during the Thursday evening clap for the NHS. People have been welcoming bin men into their driveways with little thank you notes and biscuits. The council have been welcoming rough sleepers into their empty hotels and other accommodation. And churches have been welcoming people into Facebook, YouTube, Zoom worship, Bible study and discussion. People have even been welcomed into virtual film nights, quizzes. I have friends who had a cocktail party. And locked away like the disciples in the upper room, people have been hugely creative in being and welcoming Jesus. And something as simple as a picture or a teddy in the window has made people smile as they pass by. In every welcoming gesture, we are welcoming God. And this morning, I'd like to reflect on how we can offer a welcome as individuals, as a church, and as a nation. How do we welcome those who will be coming into our church buildings as we begin to be able to offer services again? And how do we welcome those that perhaps haven't been before? Those that we've made connections with through our own online services? How do we show hospitality to our local communities and demonstrate that we do care about them? And how do we welcome those who come as strangers into our country? At the moment, we're working hard as a church to prepare our buildings so that it is safe to welcome back our congregations. But as I said, we've welcomed many people into our worship through live streaming services. Some of those are people who can't attend church normally because of physical barriers, distance, or because they are caring for others. Some are those that are spiritually searching and want to know more about deep God, to have a deeper relationship. And so now is the time for us to be creative and imaginative, to rethink how we're going to welcome people into our churches and so that they can develop that deeper and closer relationship with God. Now, the opposite of a welcoming atmosphere is a hostile atmosphere environment. The government's policy of creating a hostile environment for illegal immigrants proved disastrous to our society, leading, among other things, to the Windrush scandal. It created fear, encouraged suspicion, perpetuated divisions, and demonised vulnerable human beings, all in the hope that people would voluntarily leave this country. It cultivated not welcome, but rejection. Now we know that Lancaster is a city of sanctuary, and there are many local people who work very hard to welcome and support refugees and asylum seekers. And I know that of people personally who've really gone out of their way during the pandemic to help our guests in Lancaster. But we all have a part to play. And if we shut ourselves off from other human beings, we risk shutting ourselves off from God. Jesus refers to giving a cup of water to these little ones. And so as we start to come out of lockdown, we need to ask ourselves, who are the little ones needing our generosity at this time? As a church, we need to strive towards being a tea croso, a house where all feel welcome and are enabled to encounter God through the hospitality they receive. Amen. And so we now affirm our faith through the words of the Creed. Do you believe and trust in God the Father, source of all being and life, the one for whom we exist? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Son, who took our human nature, died for us and rose again? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God and makes Christ known in the world? We believe and trust in him. This is the faith of the Church. This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And this morning our prayers are led by Melissa, who is part of our congregation at St. Wilfrid's.
Father God, we are constantly reminded that we are living in the strangest of times as the virus pandemic covers the globe. Please give us the grace to remember that you, dear Lord, never change, that you will always be with us as a source of comfort, joy, and strength. Lord, in thy mercy, hear our prayer. Father God, we pray for all the countries of the world and the people within them. We pray for the wisdom and compassion of all leaders, political and spiritual, and give them the grace to decide what is best for all their people. Lord, in thy mercy, hear our prayer. Father God, we look at our country and we pray for the frontline workers who have given so much in the past 3 months. We pray for those working in our NHS who have gone beyond what is expected of them. We pray for the shop workers, school teachers, delivery drivers, waste disposal teams, postal workers, and so many countless others who have kept this country going. Lord, in thy mercy, hear our prayer. Father God, we pray for our church. Now at last we are able to open our doors once again to our congregations. Give grace and wisdom to the church hierarchy, so that we can restart our services joyfully and prayerfully and safely. We pray for all priests who have been so inventive in providing a virtual church, proving that a congregation doesn't have to be together in one building to worship you. We pray that our parishioners are able to feel that they can return to our churches and that they will be welcomed home. Lord, in thy mercy, hear our prayer. Father God, we pray for our children. They are our future and infinitely precious. And we thank you for them and for the gift of life that you have given them. We thank you for their growth, their good health, and their individual personalities. As most of them are at home being schooled, may they discover the adventure of life for themselves. May they be safe. May they have fun. May they learn new skills as well as new facts. May they learn to listen, to care, and to work hard. Lord, in thy mercy, hear our prayer. Father God, we bring to you in our prayers all those we know of who have suffered with COVID-19. We ask you to be close to people who remain extremely ill and may be facing death. May they know comfort in their darkness, sense your presence in their bleakness, and hope in their anguish, and help them find your strength. We ask you to give courage to those who have other illnesses and have not been able to access diagnostic tests or treatment. We ask you to look after those who have had to shield and have been so lonely, or those who have been in nursing homes and have been denied the joy of family visitors. Please shine a light on their lives. Lord, in thy mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all those who have died, and grant them eternal life in your wonderful heaven, and give us all direction when we don't know which way to turn. Give us courage when the path gets narrow and rocky, and give us peace when the way becomes uncertain. Lead us all in the end, dear Lord, to your outstretched arms. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
Amen. And so now, as we prepare the plea to share the peace, please perhaps make a response, a comment or a like or whatever, and so that we know that you're here with us worshipping. We are all one in Christ Jesus. We belong to him through faith, heirs of the promise of the Spirit of peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. And our next hymn is a lovely hymn by John Bell. Jesus Christ is waiting, you'll know the tune. Thank you. Yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendour, and the majesty. For everything in heaven and in the earth are yours. All things come from you, and of your own do we give you. The Lord is here, his Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts, we lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. Blessed are you, Lord God, our light and our salvation. To you be glory and praise for ever. From the beginning you have created all things, and all your works echo the silent music of your praise. In the fullness of time, you made us in your image, the crown of all creation. You give us breath and speech, that with angels and archangels and with all the powers of heaven, we may find a voice to sing your praise. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord.
How wonderful the works of your hands, O Lord. As a mother tenderly gathers her children, you embraced a people as your own. When they turned away and rebelled, your love remained steadfast. From them you raised up Jesus, our Saviour, born of Mary, to be the living bread, in whom all our hungers and are satisfied. He offered his life for sinners, and with a love stronger than death, he opened wide his arms on the cross. On the night before he died, he came to supper with his friends, and taking bread, he gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of him." Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Father, we plead with confidence. His sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. We remember his dying and rising in glory. And we rejoice that he intercedes for us at your right hand. As we eat and drink these holy things in your presence, pour out your Holy Spirit as we bring before you these gifts of your creation. May they be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy things in your presence, form us in the likeness of Christ and build us into the living temple of your glory. Bring us, at last, with St. Luke and St. Wilfrid and all the saints, to the vision of that eternal splendour for which you have created us, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom, with whom and in whom
with all who stand before you in earth and heaven. We worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honour and glory and power be yours for ever and ever. Amen. So let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in the one bread. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus is the Lord. Jesus is the Lord God Almighty. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus is the Lord. Jesus is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus is the Lord. The gifts of God for the people of God. Jesus Christ is holy. Jesus Christ is Lord. To the glory of God the Father. Amen. And so I invite you to make your spiritual communion using the prayer that's on our service sheet or pew sheet. And we will hear an anthem, Lord of All Hopefulness, by Malcolm Archer. beautiful singing from the choral scholars of St. Martin's of the Fields. And so let us pray. O God, whose beauty is beyond our imagining and whose power we cannot comprehend, show us your glory as far as we can grasp it, and shield us from knowing more than we can bear, until we may look upon you without fear. Through Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Amen. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. God the Father, by whose glory Christ was raised from the dead, strengthen you to walk with him in his risen life. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and all those that you love, today and always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. And before we sing our final hymn, just like to say that next week we will be having services, 8 o'clock at St. Luke's and 10 o'clock at St. Wilfrid's. You're very welcome to join us there. We will be recording the 10 o'clock service, so that if you don't feel that it's safe yet for you to return to church, you can still join with us through the media of Facebook. So let us close with our final hymn, And Can It Be? I hope that you have a very pleasant day despite the weather.
Savior. time.